All right, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Wednesday Wisdom, brought to you by the Black Male Initiative. I'm your host, Brandon Bailey. And today I got my homeboy on here from our DuPont Manual High School days, Mr. LaVon Carter, who is an educator, a youth advocate, as well as an entrepreneur. So thank you all for joining us. Thank you for tuning in. And we're just going to get right into it. So for those of us, you know, our brothers a little further west, they know him as the youth advocate. Mr. LaVon Carter, how you doing today, sir?
I'm good, man. I'm good. How about yourself?
Man, doing wonderful, man. I'm glad we got to sit down and catch up, you know, and get to spread your story a little bit, spread, you know, the good news about the work that you're doing, man. So, but before we get into that, you know, we want to provide the people some of your background. So tell us about yourself. Where you know, where you from, where'd you grow up, and, you know, where'd you end up going to college at?
All right. Well, my name's LaVon Carter. A lot of y'all know me as Coach Carter. I'm from Louisville, Kentucky, born and raised. I ended up actually moving into Jeffersonville and then after my mom passed away. And that's where I went to middle school and elementary school also. And I ended up going to the Manual for school. The college I went to was Indiana State Sycamores, Grove Trees. I graduated, my degree was in communications. Currently, I own a part of a production company and I have my personal training organization through mental fitness and health, Dream Chasers Performance Development. So.
Dream Chasers, man. So that tells people everything you're about right there, man. I be seeing you on the net, on the gram, you know, working with people of all ages. Especially youth, you know, getting people together and their mental and their physical, learning, you know, the lessons around discipline and everything. So, man, hats off to you for that, man. So, when you was making your way through Indiana State, that's like Terre Haute, Indiana, something, right?
Yep, Terre Haute. Yep.
Terre Haute. Okay, so when you was going through college, man, what were some of the things that were issues or struggling points for you?
Well, I think my biggest struggle was not being prepared coming out of high school, not academically, but mentally, because as a high school kid, they don't teach you really about FAFSA. They don't teach you about student loans. They don't teach you about how to pay for your courses, how to pay per credit hour, how you're going to pay for your books as well as live and eat. You don't really learn those things in school. So, and then going away to college, I had to learn all of that on the fly. So I went from living with my family at home to jumping off the porch in the survival mode to where I got bills to pay. I don't know how I'm going to pay it. I got to pay for school. I don't know how I'm going to do it. I got to eat. I have no clue how I'm going to do it. And I got to get these books. So I kind of got trapped up in the taking out student loans in desperation. And that's why me personally, I don't really like making decisions when I'm in desperation mode. You tend to make the wrong decision. So that was a struggle. But then I walked on to the Indiana State football team, which was a whole another thing in itself. I love my time playing football, but being a walk-on and not being recruited, you're not particularly the coach's favorite. So there's some barriers that's created there. So whenever you're going through your personal life, going through all that, trying to figure out how I'm going to pay these bills, how I'm going to eat, how I'm going to pay for school, how I'm going to manage, and then which the thing you love to do for fun that other people see as a business, because right, you remember, you're 18, 19 years old. So these adults see it as a business. So they look at you as an employee, and you ain't even really had your first job yet. So now these two worlds are clashing. So the thing that I love most, playing football, and the whole reason I went to college is now more difficult, not because of the football, because of the business of it. And now as an adult, now the business side of life takes over. So having to try to find some type of balance with those two worlds, it took time. So I think that was probably my biggest struggle throughout college.
Actually, 100%, man. And that's a, man, fellas, I hope y'all hearing what he's saying, man, and just learning to, you know, going through college, whatever opportunities that you get, whether you're an athlete or, you know, taking on an internship or even auditing a class for that matter, you know, there's a certain time frame that college gives us to learn to, you know, okay, how do I look at myself as an upgrade in a certain professional type of manner? Some people will give you the game while you're going, you know, whether that's a coach or a professor, and then, but a lot of people will be like, figure it out.
Right.
You know, you got to figure out, like, I had to figure it out. You know what I mean? So he just that's gave me like some gems.
Tell us, I didn't get a car when I was 16. I had to get my own.
There you go, bro. I was 21, 22 before I got my first whip. So, man, I feel you.
Right.
Feel
now,
you.
Imagine if they would have got you one at 16 because they didn't want you to go through that route. You would have had a, 5 or 6 year head start now because you would have been mobile.
Right, right.
You know, but based on that thought process and philosophy, you got off to a later start. And I think as parents, we need to stop doing that to our kids. We need to try to give them every opportunity to be successful and go out here and compete in this world as possible. I'm not saying give them shortcuts and make it easy, but we can eliminate some of these crucial and tragic mistakes to speed up the learning, to, you know, so where they don't have so many delays on their learning curve, you know. So
100%, 100%, man. All facts, bro. All facts right there. So, you know, you talked about not making decisions when you in desperation mode, and learning that as a lesson early on. Unfortunately, some people, they don't get that lesson the first time or the second time or the third time, you know. But at any rate, what is a piece of advice you would tell your 21-year-old self in college?
The biggest thing I would say is don't quit, to awaken the dog sooner. Because one thing that I learned in my later years is aggressive people finish first. And when people feel that they got you beat, because humans are humans, you know, we all like the same stuff, don't like the same stuff. Certain things make us uncomfortable. But like, whenever you're able to act, at least for me, when I'm able to activate that dog, it scares people. So people are less likely to want to create, at least for me in my experiences, create some barriers. Because like I said, for example, when I walked onto the Indiana State football team, if that dog and me would have woken sooner, every workout, I would have just flat dominated and been all rah-rah from jump, as opposed to doing it later toward the end of my time there. I would have came in from gate, you know. And I think that scares people whenever, you know, you're operating at a level when they're trying to break you, and you're operating at such an efficient level, that is terrifying to people, scaring people, because what happens is that catches. And certain people don't want you to go certain places. They try to keep you down, you know, whether it's you as a person or as a group or as a culture, you know, like, it's crazy, but people hate to see you shine. And I would have told my 21-year-old self, just shine through the hate.
Shine. I can dig it, man. I can dig it. Look, I had to tell that to my 28, 29, 30-year-old self, shine through the hate, man. That's gems right there. So, getting people some of your background, you know, college athlete, college graduate, majored in communications, you know, figured your way through college and navigated through that. And now, as the educator and the youth advocate and the entrepreneur that you've grown into be, and, you know, the content creative, we can throw that in there too, that you got going on, right? We talk about planning your legacy in this episode. So for you, what is the meaning of a legacy to you, LaVon Carter?
The meaning of a legacy to me is something that maintains and sustains over the duration of time, like decades, centuries. That's legacy. And people may have forgot your name, they know your work. So that's what legacy to me is.
Dope. Okay. That's a beautiful take on it, man. We might have to call up Webster or somebody and replace their definition with what you just said, man. Sustain. I can dig it, bro. So, all right. When it comes to your legacy, what is it that you want to leave behind for your family or your children with the work that you've done?
Well, what I want to do, I want to leave them something that they can own, that they can have, you know, something that is built, a physical space, a presence that you can actually see and touch, that is also profitable. I want to create generational wealth for my family, to where years down the road, my great, 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 great grandson, his college is already paid for from the work that I didn't put in already, to where, like I said, it takes some of the delays off of the learning curve. I don't want my son to have to get it out the mud or jump off the porch early. I'd rather walk him, you know what I'm saying, right up to school, right up to the nice car, right up to the, you know what I'm saying, to give him a head start, because if he doesn't have to go through some of those struggles up front and, you know, experience some of those, you know, some of those disappointments, you know, maybe, you know, he'll go much farther than what, you know, my father did, much farther than what I am, and, you know, so on and so forth. So
let's talk about that for a second. So, you know, tell the folks about what you're doing now for that to become a reality a few years down the line. You know, tell them about the business that you got going on right now, the work that you're doing with youth.
Okay. Well, right now my organization is Dream Chasers Performance Development. The performance is your athletic ability enhancing, you know, your balance, change of direction, your motor skills, things like that. And the development is developing your character, who you are as a person. Because a lot of times people's talent will get them somewhere their character can't keep them. So they may have the brains or the athletic ability, but who they are as a person internally will ultimately be their demise. So with what we're doing, we do it through mental and health fitness. We use workout, speed and agility training, and muscle gaining, fat loss, fat burning. Because once you start to push your body through things that you didn't believe that you could, or you start achieving physical goals, it starts to really change something mentally. Mm-hmm. Because I feel personally, we operate on three planes of being: mind, body, and spirit. You know, so you have to continue to push yourself, not only mentally, but as well as physically. You know, and as we get older, you know, we tend to have different creaks and cracks in our bodies and things like that. So if we start at a young age and we just stay consistent over the duration of time, you know, hopefully we don't have some of these chronic illnesses that we typically go through, because a lot of things that we're experiencing now that we're facing health-wise, they didn't have a couple hundred years ago because they was more physically active and using their bodies more. But also more work that we're doing in the community. I'm an educator, I'm a teacher, I'm a gym teacher. So try to educate you on, you know, that the possibilities out of life, you can get in this life whatever it is that you want, if you want to dedicate and discipline yourself. And we're pretty much trying to create a space to where it is comfortable to be you, to be whoever you are, because everyone doesn't want to be an athlete or a ball player or a rapper. So we want to create and make sure that each child has the different has access to the different resources, to where they can gain the knowledge they want to become whatever it is that they want to be. So like, say, for example, if a kid wants to be a computer scientist, we want to try to refer them to the programs at a young age so that they can go out here and compete. Or if they want to become an engineer or some type of in some type of tech, you know, we want them to be able to go and apply at these jobs at Google, or, you know, at these big time companies, Facebook. You know, a lot of our kids, they don't have a chance to get none of those jobs. They don't even know how to apply, probably never heard of some of the titles. So we want to kind of, you know, at least open up the minds that you can do more, you know, that there's more out here that you can do if you have access to the resource. So we're trying to create different partnerships to make these resources available to people in their community that they may not know was available. And then on the other side, as creating content, like I said, I have a production company as well, Millennial Productions. We've done some stuff with like Develop New Albany and some other different local businesses. We did like a black local business showcase where we went out to different local Black businesses and recorded them, you know, 30-second to a minute promo video, so it'll highlight and capture their business so that they can market their brand. We've been doing podcasts as well. We're producing the podcast right now, Snack Chat, so make sure to tune into that on Wednesdays. And also, I'm also a track coach as well. I'm a high school track coach. Previously, the past 3 years, I was a high school football coach. But now that I moved back home, I'm a high school track coach, as well as the education, because I'm still teaching. I'm still motivating, encouraging, and inspiring that, you know, even adults, you know, you can take something from these organizations, from this program.
Right, right. I'm gonna clarify something, because my Wi-Fi froze up for a second. You said so you were a high school football coach before you moved back to Louisville, and so now you're a high school track coach, right?
Yes.
All right. And you was in Kansas City, right?
Yep, Kansas City, Missouri. Shout out Southeast Knights.
All right, so let's dig into that for a second. So what was it like when you became Coach Carter in Kansas City?
It was different, because inner city is much different, because Kansas City is one of them, it's a rough city, like a Detroit, Chicago, Baltimore, you know, it's a get it how you live. I love it to death though. Like, it's definitely my speed, but it's different because the mindset is much different. You really see the effects of what, you know, certain, policies that was put in place to infiltrate certain communities. You can really see the effects of that in the barriers. You can see clear cut where there's a division and there's a difference in wealth and in the way that people live and in the way that the city takes care of those neighborhoods. So for me, I don't say this the wrong way or disrespect no one. I didn't have football players. I had kids that played football. You know, like, and that's two different types of kids, because the kid who plays who's a football player, oh, he's coming and he's going in because he does this. Yeah. A kid who just plays football, you gonna do this leisurely.
Yeah.
So for me to be as intense as I am and working with people who's doing it more as a hobby as opposed to a way of life, you know, it was difficult, because that's another barrier. But then it's even deeper, because after the football game, you got kids that's 11, 12 o'clock. They don't got no ride home. So you got to try to maneuver and get them somewhere safe. But the problem with that is it ain't too many safe places, you know. And then I had kids at, you know, 14 years old having to work and pay rent. So you can't come to practice. You can't focus on the game. We can't fully do an install, you know. And whenever there's certain, then there's other kids on the team that, you know, you got to watch your baby brother, your baby sister. So it's hard to even get everyone together to get on the same page. So like I said, it was more kids playing football. I'm going to do this when I got time and when I can, as opposed to I don't have time for nothing else. This is the only thing that I'm focused on. This is my meal ticket. This is my way. But like I said, I loved it, because those experiences and the relationships that I made and built, I wouldn't trade those for the world.
Yeah, yeah. Do you feel like you saw a part of your younger self in some of the players and students that you had?
Yes, for sure. Because I was a knucklehead. I used to cut up and I used to wild out. But I like dealing with those type of kids, that the kids that people would deem, you know, unteachable or awkward or a little, you know, different, you know, because I was the same way, you know, because really all it really is about is attention. They're just really seeking attention because they're probably not getting it from home. And if they are getting attention at home, it's not the right type of attention, not the type of attention that they need or deserve or want, you know. So I connected with those kids a lot because I seen myself in a lot of them.
Gotcha. Okay, so Corona happens, you know, almost exactly a year ago around this time. And then you transition back to Louisville, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
In September. I came back in September.
Okay. So September 2020, you land back in Louisville. So what was your, talk a little bit about your mindset to transfer everything that you was doing in KC to Louisville. What was that process like?
It was, I'm gonna be honest, it was dominating at a high level and being on top to now being in an area where, who is he? You know, so I didn't have the big multi-million-dollar budget. I didn't have access to all the different fields and sports complexes or community centers. Like, I didn't have those that built. I didn't have all those partnerships in place to where I could refer the kids to get the proper help and services they need, you know, and also too, trying to find income, because at the end of the day, you can't help poor people by being one of them, and you got to cover your bottom line. And I have a son, he's 8, his name's Kingston Carter. So trying to find a job, and it is extremely competitive here. You know, it's extremely competitive here. So it's hard to find a job, and finding a job out to earn an honest man's wage. Don't sit here and pay me no $12, $13. I'm not knocking no one who makes that, but I'm just saying, based on my experiences and my body of work and what I've done, I deserve to be sitting over 20 an hour. Like, making 12 is a lifestyle change. It's hard.
Yeah.
So trying to find work and also trying to find a balance of still being true to me, because my life was, everything I do revolved around pretty much dream chasing. From the development, the organization, it was education, it was kids, it was health and fitness, it was nutrition, it was coaching, it was teaching, it was inspiring, it was motivating, like everything I did. And then coming back here, I had to cover my bottom line. I got to do what I got to do, in a sense that, you know, you got to do what you got to do until you can do what you want to do. Right. I got a son that I'm still supposed to pick up every week or two. You know, I still got bills that I got to pay and stuff that needs to be handled. So once I was able to start to get into my groove, because in the process of that, I'm going to be honest, I went through every emotion that you could possibly think of, every emotion attached to it. I went through it. But once I started to, okay, let me slow down, because I control my mind. And at the end of the day, it's not what it is. It's what it means to you. It's what it is to you. It's not what it really is. What does that mean to you? You know what I mean? So it's like, okay, forget the perception of what people's thinking about me. Forget all of that. What do I need to focus on to get back to a comfortable space internally within to myself? So once I started to, I guess, filter out the BS or the stuff I didn't need, and then I stopped letting the distractions distract me, which could be, you know, my own negative thoughts, my own self-sabotaging thoughts, you know, or, you know, a couple other things. Once I started to get back to the basics of being me, what are my principles that I stand on? What is my core value and my core belief? Faith, family, dream chasing, performance development, my production company. Then from there, it's, you know, whatever sport I'm coaching, and then from there, whatever job or career I'm doing. So if ever there's ever a conflict, my decision was already predetermined, so I can never make the wrong decision based on something emotional or being in desperation, right? So when going back to that foundation, let's break this down. And I started categorizing things. I was able to do that. I was able to then start to see the full picture develop, because I was in control. I'm in control.
Right.
It's going how I'm making it go. You know, like I'm making it go that way because of my thoughts and my belief at that time. So once I started to, like I said, categorize and filter out some of the BS, then I can get back to my core beliefs and value. And if it had nothing to do with that, I didn't have any time for it. Yeah. So once I started to get back into my groove, okay, educating, working with kids, getting back in health and fitness, you know, back to speaking and motivating and mentoring. Now, this is me. I'm getting my son, like, now things are starting to fall into place. Now the money is starting to come and flow, right? Like, now things are starting to realign. So now it was like I was just lining it up to get ready to knock it out the park.
Yes.
Then you get back to being who you are, because some experiences take you out of your character. That's why, like, you always have to remember in the dark how you felt in the light when you first started. When it gets hard and tough, you got to remember that. And I was at times losing sight of that. Like, when it got dark and hard, I was losing sight of who I am. Because Nip said a quote, and I want to make sure I get it right. He said, the game's going to test you. Don't fold. Keep it your toes down. It ain't on you, it's in you. And what's in you, they can never take from you. And those words stick to me. And I try to be a living embodiment of that.
Hey, man, I'm always here for a good Nip quote, man. Like, Nip, Tupac, Muhammad Ali, you know, to keep within the culture, it's a few others outside of our, you know, immediate Black culture. But I'm always here for that, man. And more so, you know, I appreciate your perspective, you know what I'm saying, on being able to look back and have that full capacity to see, okay, I was in the light right here. And then things got a little funny. And maybe that's when, like, I had to be my own light for a second and remember, you know, minister to myself and remember, okay, how did I feel when I was in the light? So let me focus on those emotions. Let me focus on those thoughts and harness that until it becomes my reality. You know what I mean? And guys, a lot of time, you know, we talk about legacy building, but, you know, when you look back, when you look at, like, say we're looking at sports, right? You know, Tom Brady got all the highlights in the world. He's the greatest quarterback ever lived, maybe greatest football player, you know. But when they're talking about your legacy, they don't show, you know, a player grinding through practice with broke ribs or a player, you know, trying to get their head back right, you know, do 3 interceptions in 1 game. They don't show them highlights. You know what I mean? They don't talk to you about those down moments. So what Coach Carter is giving us right now, going through the motions of and emotions of coming back, you know, back home in the midst of a pandemic and leaving a place where he had made home and was making, you know, a safe space for youth in Kansas City, and now coming here and build from scratch. You know what I mean? So, and still take care of his family at the same time. Like, that's legacy building. So it's like, even when you feel like you're necessarily in your flow, sometimes, you know, building your legacy is just showing up and doing the things that you know you got to get done no matter what, and just having that grit and determination to do that. So that's a lesson that you can take from Coach LaVon Carter, man. Don't fold when the game tests you, 100%, man. So, yeah, don't fold at all. Don't quit. Don't fold. None of that. Just keep moving forward, man. So before we get up out of here, LaVon, man, you know, we got to take it to the culture a little bit, the culture a little bit, and, you know, see, you know, what kind of flavors that you're tasting right now, man. So movies, music, whatever, you know, what's in entertainment, what's got your ear, what's got your attention right now?
I'm going to be honest, man. This little dude I've been listening to recently, man, who's Shiesty, man. I've been bumping him lately.
I just heard about him. I just heard about him, like, yesterday.
Yeah, I ain't heard too much about him before a couple weeks ago. I knew he did the song Get It In Blood or Back In Blood. That was the only thing I heard. It did, like I said, we have a production company that has partners And one of our companies that we work with, one of my good buddies, DJ West and DJ Posey over at Kentucky Audio and Party Prep, they actually set up all the sound equipment for his show when he came to Louisville. Okay. You know, so being partners and we own the production company together, you know, obviously I got to come, you know, and do videos and record and get B-roll and behind the scenes footage and help set up. So I had a chance to, you know, meet his crew and his DJ. I didn't get a chance to meet him, but at the concert, I was listening to him and he was rocking. So I've been listening to Pooh Shiesty real hard lately. All right. But that's when going to the concert and being a part of it.
Bet. What about movies or shows? What you looking at right now?
Well, I've been looking at a lot of like YouTube videos, more or less than movies. Like right now, I'm watching Eric Thomas, Eroding Your Success. I watch different interviews of successful people. Like I watched the No Limit documentary. I watch Nipsey Hussle interviews. I watch Gary Vee's interviews, and different like people's rules for success. And I've pretty much been just following a lot of successful people's stories and journeys and what they've been through and how they went through it, how they overcame it, if they overcame it. And, you know, but yeah, I've been watching a lot of, you know, documentary style types.
Another gem right there, ladies and gentlemen. Emulate the greats. Yeah. Once you look, listen, in the words of the great American philosopher Sean Carter, once you have filet mignon, it's hard to go back to hamburger helper. You know what I'm saying? So if you take it in great, it's hard to go back to stuff that maybe you didn't realize it wasn't great back then. But once you get exposed to the thoughts and lifestyles of people that's in their flow, and you know, if it ain't your particular industry, but just seeing how they approach life and how they approach their craft, man, on the level of greatness, and it's sustained. Everybody he just named, like, been doing it for years. Gary Vee, God bless the dead with Nip, but he been doing this thing well before he became who we know him as now.
Master P.
P. Oh man, P been grinding all his life, literally.
Yeah.
Literally. Matter of fact, so little known fact, Master P actually was supposed to play basketball for University of Louisville. He blows out his knee.
I did not know that.
So like within the same year, he blew out his knee, and his older brother had got killed. And so he ended up, you know, because of them unfortunate incidents, he ended up going to University of Houston and doing this thing there for a little bit. So, so it's crazy how stuff kind of ties together. You know what I'm saying?
So he probably still got some little connections. I've seen him come here. I don't know if his daughter went to college out here or something, but I feel like he got some connections here. Hey, so P, if you see this, man, hey, connect. What's up?
Hey, offline, we can, off of this, we can make that. Yeah, I get with you. Yeah, we can make that happen. Okay, talk about the music, talk about, you know, what you're looking at. Again, everybody, this brother is an educator, he's a coach, he's a motivator, he's a speaker, he's an entrepreneur, he's a father. You know what I mean? Just on and on and on. We're going to run out of fingers in a second, right? So what are you doing for self-care?
Well, what I've been doing is I have routines. I'll typically wake up anywhere between 3 or 4 in the morning. And what I do, I like to spend time with myself, personal development. So typically at that time, I'm doing some type of creation of content, whether it's, you know, creating some type of new post, or, you know, getting one ready to post at like 6 or 7 in the morning. Then from there, I'll go into my workout routine. I'll usually work out for, you know, about an hour, hour and a half, then get ready to go to work. And then I'm a gym teacher, so I got access to the gym. So I usually run like a mile or something you know, in there because I don't have class for the first couple of periods. My first period is playing, my planning period. My second period is my lunch period. So I'll just work out and pretty much get my mind right. Then from there, a lot of those speeches that you guys have been seeing is coming after those workouts. That's why sometimes when I'm stumbling on my words, I'm popped. I'm tired. I've just been working out. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So then it's therapeutic, at least for me. It's therapeutic doing what I love because I don't work a job that I dread going to. So every moment of my life, I am happy with where I am and the people that I'm with and what I'm doing. So now I don't have to take so much time, you know, to myself because I evolved from that a little bit because I was able to start to create safe spaces, you know, to bring me with the kids. And I'm an elementary school teacher, you know, I got the babies, you know, so how could you not be happy with that? Then from there, go off to track practice. So now I got the high school kids, the young adults that I'm preparing to go get ready, you know? So then after that, you know, go home, shower, eat, spend some time with my father, then to the studio,
yeah,
you know? So, and now we're with the production company. We're working on getting bigs and getting different contracts with companies. So for me, I just try to spend as much time doing what I love and to remembering those positive thoughts that put me in those good spaces. So, and I take care of my body. I make sure I try to watch what I eat. I watch what I do. I try to work out and stay active because I don't want to be the out of shape trainer that's telling you to do all this stuff and I can't do it.
Hey, I want to do that
with you.
Remember, what was our track coach name, bro?
Coach Roster.
Coach Ralston, hey, listen, Coach Ralston was good people's man, but Coach Ralston didn't miss too many meals, bro. He ain't missed too many meals.
Coach Ralston, my God, bro.
Listen,
yeah, hey, man, but he could still run. He could still get out there and do his thing and show us what we needed to learn, though.
Yeah, it ain't gonna last too long, but he can show you. He messed me up with them hurdles times, you know. You know, I'm not like this. But it's all good though, man. So fam, though, man, we gonna wrap this up, man. Appreciate you telling the young boys how to start off your legacy. You know, you talked about having a spirit of perseverance. You talked about, you know, developing your personal format of how you make decisions that are outside of an emotional state with, you know, faith, family, your business that you got going on. And then after that, everything else kind of falls into order. So, man, we appreciate you and we appreciate the work that you're doing, man. You've been back in the city in, you know, less than a year. You know, I'm going to definitely do my part. And, you know, to further your connections with folk, you know, as a dynamic youth advocate, you know what I mean? The city definitely needs your energy right now. We got a lot of issues happening. And, you know, a lot of times just folks just need some direction, you know what I mean? So, fellas, if y'all trying to get into shape, if you got a younger sibling that, you know, maybe out here a little bit, you know, we can link you with Coach Carter, you know what I mean? Have some sit down time with him and, you know, get your mind right, get your body right, you know what I mean? And we gonna be all right, in the words of Kendrick. So, my brother, before we get off here, man, is it one? Before we get off here, what's one piece of advice you would offer to, you know, today's young brothers making it through college?
I would say, whether it's college or professional or whatever it is you're doing, just don't quit. Don't quit. Always remember your intuition too, because times, you know, we can't always lean on our emotion and we can't always lean on logic. Sometimes you just got to go with that gut feeling. So don't quit. Whatever it is you're doing, just don't quit. Just keep going through the phases, go through the process, because in going through the process, I learn how to maneuver those different stages. But if you keep quitting and starting over, it's going to make your journey take much, much longer. So imagine if you're trying to swim across the sea and you get more than halfway done. So what are you going to go back? It's farther to go back, or are you going to sit there and drown, or are you going to finish and keep going? So whatever it is you're doing, just don't quit.
Don't quit. Don't quit. Wise words from a wise man. Hey, we appreciate you, my brother. And everybody, you'll see Coach Carter's contact. Well, we ain't gonna put his personal stuff out there, but his business contacts in the description below. Make sure you follow him on all the social media outlets and pick his brain, man. He might be somebody that holds the keys to the future that you say that you want. So that's what the Black Male Initiative is here for. And stay tuned for the next episode.
Peace.